Hello again. Welcome back to our channel, The Cactus Atlas. I'm Glen, and I'm going on a float trip. So just to give you the brief synopsis of what's going on is, I am doing something called the Glen Canyon Backhaul, and it's a float trip where a service, like a taxi service, will tow your kayak or boat and yourself and some gear upstream near Glen Canyon Dam, and then you float back down the Colorado River in the canyons like the whole time with some cool stops along the way. And I've seen other people's videos, and I'll mention some things about those like a little bit later because they're worthy of note. But anyway, it's that. But I have a lot of things to consider, you know, for filming, and that's what I'm gonna show you here. Because they do have weight limits, and I don't, they're probably, if it's not ridiculous, I doubt that they're gonna say anything, but, and I tipped them already. So, basically, I'm trying to figure out exactly what I need, how I wanna bring all the cameras, the batteries, and how I want it organized. I have wet bags. And one of them is here, and I like the bright orange one because that's where my wallet, keys, and I would just say like my identity stuff, and my phone will probably go in there also, but I've got a bag for that, and then I have another wet bag. I think it's in the car still, actually, so I'm gonna have to go get that later, but it's a bigger one. I think it's a 20 liter. Got a towel in here too. Oh, shoot. That wasn't good. That was just the my camera cleaning kit, which I'm gonna bring because you never know if you get spray on the lens. But I know this seems a little haphazard, but I actually have thought this out very well and kind of have a checklist of what I need to do. And there you kind of have a glimpse now. I'm not gonna spend much more time here talking to you because I need to go to bed. I'm tired, but I can't sleep, you know, because I'm kind of excited and have some anticipation and nervousness about one of the phases of this operation. And I'm gonna save it for the morning, which for you should be momentarily. So I will see you guys again then. Why, good morning from the Vermilion Cliffs and right outside of where we're heading to. It's a beam of sun shooting through, and we're just now starting to get our first rays of light on the Vermilion Cliffs right outside my quarters here at Marble Canyon Lodge. I'm feeling pretty good, actually. All my preparations are paying off, so I'm not as rushed and trying to get things done as usual. I'm trying to get myself close to an hour to prepare when we get to the destination to inflate my kayak and all that stuff. So I don't want to dilly-dally here too much. Let's get in here. I got the water ready for the journey. Plenty of liquids to hydrate. And I'm currently in hydration mode now. And the current time is 6:12 a.m. as we head towards the Colorado River to prepare. Look at this beautiful scene, the Vermilion Cliffs again. And we're out near Cathedral Wash, which I filmed a video at that maybe a year or two ago. That was amazing. I want to redo that one. I don't know if I'm going to do it on this trip, but one of my favorite hikes in Arizona. So my nervousness now is more about the boat that I have, the kayak, and its size. It is sizable. It's a 13-foot inflatable angler's kayak, a Aqua Glide Blackfoot 130, complete with a lot of mounts for cameras and fishing gear and all sorts of stuff. It's not light. I want to say it's like 50 pounds or something, 40, 50 pounds, but it's really like long and hard to manage and move. I have a dolly so I could pull it, but I don't know the situation when we get to the boat, if they're gonna help me put it in there. Also, my nervousness is the website said that there's a max size limit of 14 feet. I am at 13 feet. That's why it's called the Blackfoot 130. It signifies 13. They have a 16-foot boat, for example. That's the Blackfoot 160. So. It's definitely 13 feet. Anyway, and I have to inflate the boat, so I never timed myself doing it, but if I hustle and do it hard and fast, I think we'll be okay. I think we'll get it done.
in time, no problem. It's just, I just don't know where I'm gonna park in relation to where the boat launches. So that's my other slight concern. If I remember, there's a parking lot right near the boat launch. I just don't know if it's gonna be full already. At 6:15 a.m. you would think not, but you never know. And here's my kayak, kind of loaded up with all my gear and goods for the trip. 13 foot, the Blackfoot 130. Still have to name this thing officially. And I know the sound is gonna sound different than usual because I'm using a mic I don't usually use for this GoPro. So hopefully the sound's gonna come out okay. I think it will, hopefully. But if it sounds weird or off, it's the best I can do in these conditions. All right, so here's the ride. So we're gonna load this up here shortly. And we'll be ready. Did I tell you I'm super excited about this? I would say I'm, you know, there was no worry about the size of my boat, so I think we're okay. And so I think my nervousness is starting to go down. I inflating it this morning was really easy. It went really fast. So unlike when I tried to do it the first time. So probably got it done in like 10, 15 minutes. So that it's done quickly. So if you have questions like I did, yes, the boats launch from this area, not where the big rafts go that go downstream towards the Grand Canyon. So it's a different area. Dropped off. You see a big group. A lot of people have chosen to come all the way up to the dam today, so I'm not the only one. I feel better about that because it's the furthest point you can go up the river. This deal today I think is about a 9 mile, I want to say, trip, and it's gonna take me all day, I predict. They predict like a 9 hour tops kind of scenario with me filming. Add a couple more to that. It's gonna be probably, we'll see how it goes. Luckily I have my phone. I'm gonna try to remember to time it before I get into the water and get really started here, and we'll see. I'll keep track for you. There are some stops along the way, two in particular. There's this thing called the Descending Deer Petroglyphs, which are some amazing petroglyphs, apparently. I've seen pictures of them. Maybe about, some say halfway between the dam and Lee's Ferry. That guy said, if I get to the petroglyphs, I might be a little over halfway, but I think it's a 7.5 mile point. All throughout the stream, there are camping sites also. So you'll see like restrooms. They have like vault toilets actually in this canyon. And it's all canyon, by the way. You can get off anywhere you want or anywhere you can get off. There's no restrictions to that. And other than that, yeah, you're required to have a life vest by law, I think. And what else can I tell you? Just the usual stuff you would know. Pack your trash in and out. Don't poop on the shore.
I've already seen lots of anglers. I think there's brown trout, like renowned trout fishing in these rivers here. Saw bighorn sheep on the way up. I don't think I got them on the GoPro because I couldn't zoom in. But it was pretty awesome, actually. Everybody's having a great time. And it's going to be hot today. Now, Amy and I do have kind of a name for this craft, but I'm going to appeal to you guys to come up with something better. Ours is dumb. It's we're calling it the SS Baller for now because I keep saying this boat is baller, and I never use that term. It's like 10 years out of date. Maybe I'll explain for this demographic what that means if you don't already know what it means, but it means premium, I would say. It means awesome, baller. But if you're interested in doing this, I read you cannot put in your boat anywhere. There's really no roads or anywhere to get here. You can only either by your own power paddle up here, or you can use motorized craft here, probably with permit, or you get a tow, you get a taxi like I did. I paid $80 for that, plus tax, and then you have the option to tip. And I did tip. I thought that was like nice to do. So I gave them like a 20% tip when I paid. And I think the tip was well worth it. And there's reasons I'm gonna tell you why. It was actually kind of thanks for something they did for another YouTuber I was watching. You know, it seems like a really good outfit. And I'm gonna tell you all those stories as we float, but we really gotta get the SS Baller into the water, don't you think? All right, welcome to the SS Baller, folks. We're taking off. Right now, if I can get out of here, I gotta push off. Up, I need to get in deeper water because I'm too fat, I think. Come on. I'm stuck in some sand or something here. You got it. There we go. Just wanted to capture these first few moments of me fumbling around for your entertainment. Hopefully the sound is okay. I'm using the GoPro Media Mod for this one, which is not my usual jam. I usually have a separate mic hooked up to it. That I've learned is not the best choice, I think. But we are on the Colorado River right now. Oh my God. It's the first few moments of this epic freaking float trip, guys. Ah, yee freaking ha. So the river flow, I confirmed with the guy, if I already didn't say it, is about 3.5 miles an hour, which is the average. Which is good because you don't want it to be too slow, I think, or else it's going to make this float take a long time. And there's no wind right now. I think if there is going to be wind, it's going to be blowing with us downstream. So that should help a little bit. So we'll see. I forgot to get my phone out and check what time it is. So I'm going to do that really quick so we can officially document what's up with us in case you want to do it. Alrighty, so it's 8:38 a.m. was my, we're going to just say 8:30 because if I had checked it on the shore, it probably would have said 8:30. So we started at 7 a.m. I had to take that second boat, so I started a little later than I had planned, but overall, I would say the schedule I'm keeping, as I fix that, is looking good. I think we're in good shape. And this is, so far, a treat. It's very gentle. It's supposed to be class one all the way to Lee's Ferry, so we're not gonna hit any rapids or anything. It's very gentle. It's like one of the gentlest floats I've ever done. I haven't done many in my time, but my family used to do like canoe trips in Missouri, and I remember there were some rapids there, and I've done one whitewater rafting excursion in West Virginia on the New River when I was probably a freshman in high school or something like that. We got some wake. Some waves. Look at that. That's fun. I'm a novice at this. This is my, I would say my first real excursion, because I don't know if I'm going to count the one that I did already that you'll probably end up seeing. I don't even know if it's video worthy, but this one for sure. The thing that I'm doing, by the way, is just known, I've heard it referred to as the Glen Canyon Backhaul. We're in the Glen Canyon National Recreation Area. And then I'm staying down, there's another canyon, Marble Canyon, downstream. I'm not sure where the canyons start, but eventually it turns into the Grand Canyon. All these very waters right here are going to go through all of those rapids in the Grand Canyon, where you see big river rafting boats launching from Lee's Ferry, like big excursions. Something maybe that I want to try, you know, in the future, maybe bring the GoPros and give that a whirl. I love some adventure like that. Now I'm gonna be in the shade here, and I'm curious, like, it was like coming up here, just being in the shade, it cools off like 10 degrees. Let's see. No, not really. This is, I would say, as hot as it's supposed to be today. Right now is the perfect temperature. I know it's early at 8:30-ish, we're probably going on 9, but this is, I just don't have the words for this one, to be honest with you. This is special. This is something I'm kicking myself for not having done ever before, or even knowing about the services that do this. I just had no idea. So hopefully, if anything, I've given you guys that knowledge, so one or two of yous can come check this out sometime. One thing that made me feel better about doing this too is the company that took me up here, Kayaking the Colorado. If I'm getting it wrong, Amy, fix it for me. There's another YouTuber, this is the part I'm gonna kind of tell you the story. There's another YouTuber I watch, and Jerry Arizona is the name of it. I know some of you have said, oh, you watch him too. So I'm not surprised. I think I'm kind of the Homer Simpson version of Jerry Arizona. So if you know, he's more adventurous, more in shape, and I'm like the Homer Simpson of the river here. But he's made a couple videos on this. I think he and his wife came, and then one time he came, and I learned a lot of really good stuff. Mainly that this service existed, and he recommended the company. And the reason why he recommended it too is that he came here, and he and his partner had some issues. There was some unexpected weather on the river, rain, probably colder, and there was like hypothermia danger and all sorts of stuff. So we'll put links in the description down below to those videos, but finish our video first, please. That's why I was hesitant to say anything too early, because they're probably better than mine. A lot of people are fishing, and it's kind of what this boat was designed for, actually, is more for the fishermen. All of those mounts are, you know, they're made for cameras, because fishermen like to film and take pictures of their catches, so that's part of it. But also you can mount fishing poles to this thing, multiple, however many you're allowed to have. But I don't have permit, I don't have equipment, and I've been experimenting or thinking about, do I want to incorporate fishing on the channel? I do. But others I've talked to said, you know, not too interesting, but I wasn't thinking like full on, like a whole episode of fishing, but like right now, maybe bring a line and cast it in while we're looking and talking about other stuff, you know? All right, here's my other camera now. I'm not using the GoPro, but I'll kind of give you some views from the driver's seat from what I'm seeing. I'm just letting the river take me now. That sounds horrible. Like it's gonna kill me. Looks like the current's faster on that side, actually. And it's pretty stagnant over here. I'm kind of just sticking to the right, because that's what most people do, and it's probably correct with the right of way. But mostly fishermen kind of hang out here towards the shore. But you can really see, like, you know, we're gonna be in a canyon this whole time. This is like a river, the Colorado River in a canyon, like a miniature Grand Canyon. Think of it that way, maybe. So I'm deciding to cut over here to the left, I think, where I see the current is a lot faster. Not rapids or anything like that, but I think it might be a little bit more efficient. And I'll just stick closer to the left side of the shore. I don't think I'm gonna be causing any problems that way. I've seen paddlers on either side, and the guy did say you could go on either side, but the key is mainly just stay to the side. Kind of right in the middle of the river now, actually, but that's all right. We're floating now, we're moving, finally. I've got so many little gadgets on me, they should call me Inspector Gadget up in here with this stuff. All right, now we're talking, now I can feel us moving. We're cruising, baby. Probably a whole three and a half miles an hour, but yeah, this left side's definitely the ticket. I don't really even have to paddle for the moment. I can kind of chill and enjoy the views, although I'm getting kind of turned around now, but whatever. I mean, it does not get much more amazing and beautiful in life than moments like this. like these are the types of things we should live for, and I do live for. This is next level. I mean, this is, I'm just gonna be saying that the whole time, man. This is next level. Absolutely next level. So yeah, I guess this is one of those things. I have to say it again. I have to thank that channel, Jerry Arizona. I don't know him, you know, and I'm sure he doesn't know me, but it really, it's just, I don't know if I ever would have discovered this without that. It's just really, thank you, thank you, thank you. So hopefully, in the off chance one would see something like this, just know that the work, it really does matter sometimes to people.
Got some nice little wake here and rapids to go with it from one of the boats that just passed through. Try to do some one-handed paddling here while I try to film. Adventure Idiot should be the name of the channel. All right, I checked my offline maps. I'm using Onyx Off-Roads actually for this, if you want to know. And I downloaded offline maps. I just needed to download two 10-mile maps, 10-mile areas. And I know where everything is. I know where I'm at. And Horseshoe Bend is going to be, I think we're going to go around another bend and then another bend. And I think it'll be pretty obvious when we see it. And let me think. I think those petroglyphs might be before it, because I was with the other people when he pointed it out, and then shortly thereafter he dropped them off. So I think it might be sheep, descending sheep petroglyphs is what it's called, maybe followed by Horseshoe Bend. I didn't mark the petroglyphs because I wasn't sure where they were. I couldn't find them on GPS or anything, but the guy pointed them out, so I know what to look for. And I know what to do right now, which is just lean back, lean back, lean back and enjoy. Backwards is fun too. It's kind of listening to those bugs, whatever those are, cicada-like, cricket-like things, I don't know. I love that sound though on the river. It's very calming to me. Very summer. Anyway, let's just float on down the stream, and I guess if I forget the if I don't see the petroglyphs, I'm gonna be bummed, but it's not gonna be the end of the world, because this trip is still well worth it. I do like that thought though of, you know, natives and people living here or venturing down here in the pre-Columbian times, and just what they must have thought of all of this. I'm sure it was for them a source of food and maybe a respite from the heat. I'm sure they spent lots of time down by the river. Getting off and cooling off here, which I think is nice because it's hot. I'm kind of thinking of doing the same thing, and I wonder if this is the petroglyph area. This could be it, actually. I need to find a good place to pull on because I don't want the boat to float away here. I'm gonna go scout up here and see. All right, I'm standing here in the water, kind of going knee deep now, and it is refreshingly cold. Everybody that jumps in has survived so far, but it does, it's always accompanied by a woo, kind of a Ric Flair kind of cheer. But I saw a couple fellow kayakers, the ones that had the green boat, and they said the petroglyphs are in fact here, and a bunch of restrooms too. This is a day use area only, so we didn't miss it. Now, all up and down the river, they got these porta potties. They're stacked here. They got a lot of them. Why don't I just poke my head in one? We do a bathroom check and see how they look. Oh, they're actually pretty nice for being down here on the river. I mean, come on. Like, you have all these facilities up and down the river. It's really nice. It's a nice trail too. I'm here to tell you though, that now I'm feeling the heat blast coming up here on the land. It's amazing how much of a difference in how hot it is. Just getting off the water makes it. I mean, it's it's hot. Woo, is it hot. The best part about these petroglyphs though, is that to get to them, the only way to get to them is by water that I know. I don't know if you can hike down here. I don't think you can unless you want to climb down those canyon walls. No, thank you. I'm gonna film this because every once in a while someone tries to call me out like I'm making crap up or whatever, but this panel, according to the National Park Service, not me or the US Department of the Interior, is estimated to be between 3,000 and 6,000 years old. And that is old. Wow, like the contrast and the depth actually of these etchings is great. You can even see the little pock marks, I think, where they probably chipped away on these, but now you can see why they call it the descending, the guy said the descending sheep panel. I was calling it the descending deer. Now I'm confused, but does one of the signs say descending sheep? It is indeed the descending sheep. He was right. And you got, I mean, I don't know if those are supposed to be sheep or deer though. They look more deer-like to me than sheep, although the horns do look kind of sheep-like. There are other ones that absolutely remind me of bighorn sheep. This thing, I don't even know what that's supposed to be. You got like human-shaped ones. These look older to me, the ones over here. Those bighorn sheep, but apparently the people, obviously I saw bighorn sheep today too. So the people that were here would have seen many of them. They probably dined on them, I would imagine. But I always wonder, like, what do these things mean? Is it maybe someone's keeping a tally of how many they killed? That's one thing I wonder sometimes. If they killed an animal, maybe they do that to honor it or for some kind of ceremonial reasons. But I love that. Like that, it makes sense why they call it descending sheep. It is like descending down. And it's just really curious. Why did somebody do it? Oh my God, I was like walking here and there was a, what I think is a chuckwalla. See a lot of these in Arizona. They're not really that afraid. They can get pretty close to them, but I don't want to bother you, my friend. I just want to show the audience, one of you guys, how plump you are and juicy. How beautiful you are too. I didn't even notice, but down there, there's a line of deer or sheep. I keep saying deer, but bighorn sheep, like right underneath the descending ones, but this is amazing. All right, I'm gonna say goodbye to our little reptile friend. He's actually eating. He's eating these little green leaves. Would you eat out of my hand if I feed you green leaves? Let me try. Let's see if you eat that. Holy crap, it's eating out of my hand. Alrighty, I think Horseshoe Bend is actually right up here. We found the petroglyphs. So this next like curve we're gonna go through, Horseshoe Bend. That actually might be, we might be entering Horseshoe Bend right now. I'm trying to spot the observation point up there. You can hear those person's echoes too, that's really cool. But anyway, yeah, as soon as I can spot the top, then I'll know that I'm there. I know what it looks like from this side, from coming up the river, so I also have some other clues. So let's get down a little bit further, but I might be able to actually get off on foot on the right side of the bank and get a look at the very top. I mean, this right now, to me, is a moment to savor being down here and just like chilling completely and enjoying it. It's, I actually distinctly remember being up there a couple of years ago for my first time up on the Horseshoe Bend overlook and looking down, and I maybe even zooming in with my camera at the shore straight ahead of us. Like, this is gonna be the pinnacle of the horseshoe, if, as it were. We're gonna go around the other side, almost like back in the different direction to complete the horseshoe.
but I remember looking down at that shore saying, I wonder if you can camp there. I wonder if you can walk down there. I wonder what it would look like from way down there. Well, I am here now doing this. Looks like we can indeed pull over here. There's actually people set up with tents, so this is one of the campgrounds. How cool would that be to camp underneath Horseshoe Bend? I'm still looking up there at people. I'm gonna wave. Not that they can make out my details and I can't make out theirs, but looks like there's plenty of spots up here to pull over. So I'm gonna take advantage of this really quick and we'll see what campground life is like down here at the bottom of Horseshoe Bend. Once again, there's your overlook. I'm like right at the pinnacle of Horseshoe Bend, right beneath the overlook. And they're looking straight on at the center of that. And you can see lots of folks are camped out here, which would be a primo camping spot. Really chilled area though to hang out at, actually. Oh yeah, and Horseshoe Bend is the 9 mile point. This is called 9 mile campsite. There's actually more campsites here. Plenty of room for people to pitch tents. I don't think you're gonna run out of space here. There's little campfire rings everywhere. And I'm just still amazed that I'm looking right back up at people up there. I could say I was on the horseshoe, literally on it, in the water and on land. This is an achievement for me. Big achievement. Something I didn't think I'd ever be able to do. And I'm here doing it. Just goes to show you, you can too. It is getting hot now too. Really hot. I see my boat being rocked by the wake down there, but I think I have it really secure. It should not be going anywhere at all. Comment down below if you've stood where I'm standing. I wanna know who other fellow kayakers, how many of you have gotten to see people standing way up there instead of the other way around? I think I saw a mammal not far from here, which I'm assuming was a beaver. Something was kind of swimming with its head kind of above the water. And it looked like a mammal, and a beaver would be my best guess. I know that's a thing here. And then it went up on the shore, and then I saw some ducks too. So that's the wildlife sighting so far, but it was too far away for me to get the camera out and capture it in time. So I was not able to. And that chuckwalla or whatever that lizard was cool too. I'm still really enjoying that moment. Might be one of my favorite moments actually when it ate out of my hand. Away from our little Horseshoe Bend stop, and we are now going to continue down the river on our little float trip. So we've gotten to see two really cool spots, one being the Indian petroglyphs and this. I don't know which is my favorite. You know I like my petroglyphs. Fantastic. I don't think I could have picked a finer day. I know it's hot, but this is great. Everything's perfect so far. We are now well beyond the horseshoe, I think. Almost positive. I don't know if people can still see me from way up above. Not sure if they could see me to begin with. Being a speck to them, probably.
But I'm just kind of floating here now. I'm not really paddling. It's just right after Horseshoe Bend, if I look back that ways. Yeah, you can't really see it. You could see a couple kayakers coming up on me, and there's like a piece of land that juts out. It's around that that I think the horseshoe proper begins, and then goes around this whole thing and back the other way on the other side, to kind of put it in perspective for you from way over here. Hopefully this is making sense to you. And it's really nice sometimes just to not paddle, but I'm just baking in the sun. Oh my God, it's hot. Like way hotter than I thought it was gonna be. It's just, I think, because the shadows have dissipated. And we're right here, probably in the midday is my guess. Noon, 1 o'clock, something like that. I should probably look it up soon, because I can kind of now watch my fellow kayakers and paddle boarders and see how they're handling the river. And I always want to keep an eye out here for bighorn sheep, of course, because this seems like some of the areas that the guy was pointing stuff out to us. It was like terrain like that, and you really have to look. They blend in pretty good if you don't know what you're looking for. I kind of know what I'm looking for, but I also don't think they're accustomed to coming out like in the midday. They're more, I think I've seen them more in the mornings or in the late, like kind of at dusk or dawn. Like that area is usually when I have better luck, when I've seen them. And so that's what I'm gonna guess. And it looks like there's another campground too, right there, with even more restrooms. Lots of restroom opportunities. And I'm kind of wondering, I know you're not supposed to boat and drink, and I'm not advocating that at all, but would like a couple margaritas, if kept under control, be acceptable in these circumstances? Maybe a margarita. There's this really good margarita mix that I enjoy. It's one of the few things that I drink alcohol-wise anymore on occasion, and having a margarita right now with ice in an umbrella maybe behind me, that would be, that would seal the deal. That would seal the deal. Yeah, this part's pretty neat. I like this side because it's like canyon wall right up to the river. There's no land, no plants growing up next to it. It's just the force of the Colorado River cutting straight through rock. Now we're rolling by the 6 mile campsite right here. The Horseshoe Bend was the 9 mile campsite. So does that mean I've gone 3 miles downstream since Horseshoe Bend? It's possible. I haven't been filming and I've been focusing on paddling more. Try to avoid these bushes here. Taking a quick break though, because I've been paddling pretty hard for a little bit. Wanted to make some good ground here. Make sure we're keeping a good pace on this river here. Yeah, as I'm floating down this river, I'm just thinking back. I like to think of history and all the people, the men and women that have traveled down the river, especially those before pre-Columbian. I wonder if they did any kind of recreating in the river. But certainly, you know, when the West here was settled, you know, you had steamships coming up and down. There's a giant crane. I don't know if I caught that on camera on the GoPro, but that's beautiful. Or a heron or something. But anyway, just thinking of the steamships that have come down here. There's actually an abandoned steamship, a wreck, right next to Lee's Ferry that we've filmed on another episode. I didn't see it from the water. Maybe we can kind of do that this time. But a prospector like realized that it wasn't a lucrative business to be blasting, I forget the technique where they blast water into the rocks, but he just left his steamship here because it was too expensive to operate, and there's not much left now. I think a boiler or something, but it was wooden from the late 1800s or maybe early 1900s, I forget. Old. And there's a lot of old Mormon history too at the crossing. There's an old Mormon settlement actually that you can go visit right up by Lee's Ferry that we saw in a different episode also. So I like this area for some of that history tied to it. So we'll definitely recommend our Lee's Ferry episode if you're into that sort of thing. I think you'd really like it. Ooh, can you see the sweat glistening down my face? Did a time check. It's 1:38. Where did all the time go? We started it. Actually, it was literally 1:38, and I think I called it when we started at 8:38. I think I estimated more like 8:30 or so, like that. So a little bit, like 5 hours or so. I don't know. It might be close to 9. I don't know. We might got a couple hours left. I'm gonna guess it's gonna be closer to like 7 hours or so by the time we finish. It looks like we're definitely over halfway done with the whole thing, but I thought, you know, just time has been going by so slow because I had been having such a good time. Now with it being so hot, I'm ready to pull over and swim, I tell you what. Though, look at these rocks and just this landscape that we're just cutting right through. It's fantastic. I'm almost wondering if we're approaching Lee's Ferry now, because all of a sudden the further we go, the really tall cliffs are dissipating. And Lee's Ferry is a historic crossing of the Colorado, by the way, if I haven't told you. Now that you got a taste of it, you see it's all deep canyon. You're not coming in or out in there, not even on foot. You'd have to rappel like 1,000 feet in most places easily straight down to get there. So Lee's Ferry was a crossing even before the white man made his way out here to America. The natives were using it as a natural crossing, and then the white man back all the way back in the Mormon days would run ferries across it to move wagons and horses and things like that across, and people. And then even old-timey cars eventually would go across it before they built the modern bridges that we have today, like the Navajo Bridge. So it's really fascinating. It really is a fascinating history. And when you know the full stories, as I've been saying, it's one of my favorite histories in Arizona, especially the darker sides to it. I'm trying to hint that there's some darkness. If you like that darkness, watch our Lee's Ferry video. I don't know, I'm kind of in my heart saying, oh, we're probably reaching the final approach, the final mile or so, mile or two, I don't know. But every time I say that on episodes, I end up screwing myself. So we've got like 10 miles to go, I think. I think we might get close to calling it. I see a bunch of boats docked down there. I see obviously no giant cliffs anymore. I see really colorful land that looks like it was kind of blasted out, which I think it was by a guy named Spencer, a prospector here, the guy that I was talking about earlier, somewhere along the shoreline. Is the wreck of the or the remnants of his steamboat, if this is the area that I'm thinking. Some of the boats are slowing down too, so I wonder if we're getting close to the no wake zone. But this has to be close, because obviously, you know, we're not in a deep canyon anymore. All of that's well behind us now. And I think there's even a trail. There's a trail called the Spencer Trail. Another one that I think I saw, the same guy that I mentioned earlier and his wife hike, and one that I'm toying around with trying out too. I think it goes way up there somewhere, and then you can see really good views, even I think as far as Page. I think I found the remains of the wreck. The way I did it is I looked up there and I saw the interpretive signs, and I am like right on top of it. And I think it's like just a metal boiler or some metal part. I'm pretty sure that's what that is. We're right on top of the wreck right now. An old steamboat that used to patrol. It's meant for a miner and prospector to haul metal and ore and rock and stuff out of here, but they didn't have much success, so it just was left here on the shores to rot. And being that this was probably a turn of the century boat, it was all just wood and decayed away. And now that's all that's left. It's kind of eerie in a way to think that, but I am pretty sure that's what it is, and it's probably easier to actually see from up there, from my recollection. We should have some footage from our other video, actually. It's pretty cool though, isn't it? An old shipwreck. Who would have thunk that? And I'm just recording these final moments as I pull us in here to the final destination. The wind is no joke, it really pushes you. Good morning, everybody. It's now actually the next day after my little float trip, and I didn't really say my goodbyes on that episode because I was so busy packing things up and other factors, I guess, that we'll talk about here in a second. But I thought I needed to find a fitting place to end the episode and let you know a couple things that I learned as part of this trip. Now, we've been here before, so I don't want to dilly-dally too much. Not that long ago, but if you've been with our channel, we've explored these bridges before. We are, of course, on the older of the two bridges. That's the modern bridge over there, and this one now is just open to pedestrian traffic. But the cool thing is it goes over the river that we were on yesterday, the Colorado. And there is the river, the Colorado. A little reminiscent of our journey yesterday. You could see the steep wall starting to form again here. We're now below Lee's Ferry. Lee's Ferry is upstream from here. But this would be a way that a lot of river rafters would have to come that are launching off from Lee's Ferry heading into the Grand Canyon on excursions. All right, so what I wanted to talk about, a couple things. After I finished yesterday, I loaded up the boat. I actually intended on driving straight here after that, but I was pretty tired and starting to have some pain in my legs, which I'll talk about. I had a oversight, one that I'll never make the same mistake on again, I guarantee you. I got myself, maybe in my lifetime, one of the worst sunburns I've ever gotten. I don't know how well that's gonna come out on here, but basically the area on top of my knees and around my ankle is a type of sunburn pain that I've never felt. And in fact, it hurts to have the sun on it right now. So I'm going to cover up. I wore sunblock on, you know, all of my upper regions and put on some higher SPF. And as a result, I didn't get burnt, or I don't feel burnt at all. Took good care of myself there, but wasn't really thinking about the top of my legs because I always wear shorts that go down to my knees typically. But when I was in the boat, you know, they were scrunched up a bit, you know, like that. And didn't even think to put anything on there. And boy, was that a mistake. So I finished or completed around 2:30, by the way, if I didn't mention that. I did check the time. So that would have been, made it a 6-hour float for me. And I think I got it done in 6 hours because I paddled almost the whole time. And surprisingly, I have no upper body soreness. Explain that with a guy out of shape like me. I don't know. Basically, by the time I realized I was getting pretty badly burnt, I was almost done with the float trip. So all of the damage was already done. And it didn't really start to make itself known until the very end. And I knew I was going to be in for it this morning because I had pain yesterday shortly after I got back to the room. So I just kind of took it easy. I was planning on going hiking and doing other things this morning, and this is so severe and so painful. I could barely stand up this morning. I think because I was laying down for so long and I went to stand up, all of, I don't know, maybe gravity was pulling down on my skin or whatever. I had to sit down promptly. It was so painful. And I just kept pushing through that and walking around because I had to load up all the stuff out of the hotel room in my car. And eventually I've got limber enough, I think, where I can move, but it hurts. If I lift my knee up or whatever, It is pain. Like, it is a different kind of pain, I would say. So I hate giving such remedial advice like that. It's pretty obvious stuff. And it's just something that I typically don't get burnt on my legs ever when I'm outside. I don't know if it's because I'm usually upright and it's not getting the full brunt of the sun. But so it's something I just don't think about. Did that ruin my trip? Heck no, that was still one of the best things I've done in my life, I would say, and something I want to do again. But next time I do, I guarantee you I'm going to be covered in thick white paste from head to toe. I ain't messing around. I don't care what I look like, because it's not, I wouldn't wish this on my worst enemy. This is bad, really bad. But other than that, now you know what's possible out here on the Colorado. And if I did anything on this trip, there was a couple and their little daughter hanging out when I disembarked and was putting my stuff away, and they were quizzing me on, oh, how did you get up the river and how did you do all this and that? And I was able to share the knowledge that others previously shared with me. And I'm hoping, if you're ever out there, folks, that you are going to take a ride on the Colorado.